This is the Courier Talking Football. I'm Eric Nicholson, and with me are Jim Spence and Sean Hamilton. Dressed for spring, I would suggest. Are we feeling a bit of spring in the air, Jim?
Is this a
championship title race? It's all happening.
Sort of play for Eric, as
get
you
ready,
say. All
get
play
ready for
you
it. Know. Right, okay.
I've got the vest out for the first time this year, you know.
Is that symbolic or superstitious?
Very symbolic.
Do United get wins when you're in the vest?
Symbolic,
is that
yeah,
what
it could be saying an Italian striker or something like that. Who knows?
Come on.
It's interesting times, I think.
It is indeed.
We'll go on
the pitch in a minute. I think we started off the pitch at the last podcast, and we finished off the pitch. We'll start off the pitch as well, just because there's a bit of fresh news. Well, it's continuing on a theme that we were seeing coming, isn't it? You know, it's been no secret that Mark Ogren is looking for a way out, putting it to
I don't think so.
No, yeah, looking for a way. Yeah, he's looking for a way out. Yeah. Whether, I think we'll get on to the fact that whether being part of a multi-club sort of hip-style investment is a way out, I'm not entirely sure if it is. I'm not entirely sure if it's the best thing for Dundee United or Mark Ogren, but we'll discuss that. But, you know, early stage, I think what we'll basically say is Brighton and Brentford, putting Brentford probably above Brighton, have been in touch. And, you know, early stages type thing, that might be a fair way of summarising it. What's your initial reaction to it, Jim? Not surprise, I dare say.
No, well, it doesn't surprise me. I mean, I think that Hibs have opened the door to this, and the SFA have opened the door to be more correct. We're lifting the the embargo on multi-club ownership. I mean, Hibs is 29.9%,
yeah.
I think.
And it's kind of on a case-by-case basis, isn't it? A sort of thing. Yeah. When you go, lads, you know, but they'll judge every case on its merits.
Yeah, I think, that being the case, it's difficult if you're the SFA. They have sort of set
of course it is. Of course
well.
It is, yeah. Of course it is. Yeah. So, very hard to turn around and say,
well, no, you can't have
we like
that.
Bournemouth, but we don't like Brentford,
exactly.
You know.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's right. I mean, in fact, I'd heard the suggestion some weeks back that Bill Foley, I think it is at Hibs, you know, the guy who's at Brighton that we talked about last week, Tony Bloom, had actually, you know, been quite interested in Hibs, but, you know, beaten to the punch. But who knows? I mean, you know, it's early days and all of this stuff. But the key thing is that there is a changing role or a changing model of ownership in Scottish football. I don't think there's any doubt about that. You know what I mean?
It's potentially a big. It's a bigger story than just Dundee United.
Oh, it's
absolutely.
Huge.
This is sweeping Scottish football.
I mean, United are only kind of, in a sense, a part of this.
But they were always as we've always said, they were always ripe. I mean, Dundee United are the most obvious one of the lot. You know, apart from St Johnstone, who are officially on the market. You know, Dundee United are pretty close to.
They might as well be.
They might as well
given
be,
what their
yeah,
owner
yeah,
has said.
Yeah, exactly.
That's right.
Yeah.
But I mean, I think the difference is we've gone from kind of, you know, local direct ownership, if you want. You know, Dundee historically, the Mars and United going far back enough, kind of Jim McLean and the Robertsons and the Foxes and that. And Jeff, you know, Jeff at St Johnstone, two kind of American owners at United for 5 and 10 years now at United and Dundee. American owner. Possibly, I mean, you know, I presume probably at St Johnstone, probably, you know, and you know, right in the stages of kind of doing due diligence and all the rest of it. But what comes next is as opposed to the rich, wealthy individual that you've had with Keyes and, you know, and Ogren, at the Dundee clubs, is you get the wealthy individuals, but who have already got clubs and who are involved in that kind of that multi-club ownership thing already now. I mean, this is no unusual. Man City, the group.
They've got
football five or six,
huge.
You know. Yeah. And it's no unusual thing. Now, whether you like it or not is another thing entirely. What you see in it is another thing entirely. But, you know, in terms of kind of player movement, identifying players coming to perhaps Scottish clubs and all the rest of it, I suppose, you know, one of the things you have to wonder is, does it give Scottish football a much bigger footprint in terms of the potential TV market and publicity market and the money market as well. I mean, Hibs owners put £6 million in, or is about to put £6 million in. Now, in English Premiership terms, that's not even a week's wages for some players. But in Scotland, that's a lot of money.
Did they do Aberdeen many favours either, did it? If you don't spend it well.
Yeah, no, but I mean, that's a lot of money going into a Scottish club. I mean, Dundee United at the moment would kind of, you know, we jump very well, as high as you wanted them to, for the prospect of somebody putting £6 million in to spend on players and all the rest of it. And from Mark Ogren's point of view, I think Mark just wants to go. I mean,
here's the point I would make to you though, Jim. Is this maybe he's no other options, but is this for a man that wants out, is this the best way for him to get out, or is it the best way for him to get some money? Because the best way to get out is to sell the whole shebang, isn't it?
Well, that's kind of like, you know, if the building's on fire, do you jump through the window or out through the door, you know? if I was him, I would
the door, if it's available.
I'd be quite keen to take whatever I could get my hands on, to be honest with you, because...
it's at that stage,
He's not going to get £30 million back that he's invested, you know? And I mean, you know, he's put £30 million... He's obviously had money back. There have been things like sell-on clauses.
It's maybe fairer to say that he's not going to get £30 million back in one go.
Yeah, in a go, that's right. I mean, we don't know... You know, we don't know the terms of this deal, Sean. I mean, it could be that you know, whether it's the Brighton owner or whether it's the Brentford owner that comes in, puts so much down, you know, and pay him up over a period of time. It's almost like a kind of, we almost like a club owner going on gardening leave, you know, kind of like a groundsman or a, you know, a football player getting punted at a club.
Manager.
I don't know, you know. But I think the bottom line is. He's not been a bad owner by any manner of means. I know he's had his criticisms over Tony Asgard stuff and all the rest of it, and much of that was rightly so, although people weren't complaining in the very early days.
His heart has always been in the right place. You could say he's been a naive owner.
Yeah, that's the nature of football. Perhaps naive, but you know what? He'll not be the first and he'll not be the last. There is no absolute secret to running a football club. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Yeah, not at the top of the Scottish table. Interest, but you know, for long and weary, it looked as though Celtic, given Rangers' financial problems, were going to be absolutely untouchable. That we'd gone from a duopoly in Scottish football to a monopoly. All of a sudden, Rangers look as though they could win the league. So, you know, there is nothing ever that you can put your finger on in Scottish football and say that's it forever. So, this is a new looking model. If it happens to United, I don't think they'll be the last.
We're trying to judge things that haven't happened yet. We don't even know how it's going to play out at Hibs yet. When we you can see multi-club ownership or shares in other clubs across the world. So you can kind of look and see what's happened abroad. Mm-hmm. But in terms of Scottish football, we have not got a clue how this will play out. You know, say I'm not saying Brighton are ahead of Brentford, but I'm just because players coming off the top of my head here. Mm-hmm. You know, if they're sending up Lars Den Donker, with the greatest respect to Lars Den Donker
at St Johnstone.
Mm-hmm. You know, that doesn't make me feel very good about the whole prospect of it. Basically, somebody else having control of saying, no, you will be taking this player because we want this player to go up. Uh-huh. You know, that does not fill me with excitement if I was a supporter of a club. I mean, if you're a supporter of Dundee United, what would appeal more to you? The sort of known of a buyout, i.e. Akies and Ogren, or what I think is likely to happen at St Johnstone, or this share and being part of a bigger project, which would fill you with dread, which would fill you make you more excited? It's not easy, is it?
No, it's not. But I mean, personally, you put your fan hat on, and it's difficult. I think excitement is the first thing.
Well, you hear Brighton or Brentford, or I mean, well, they're not Man City and Liverpool, but you know, they're still.
And that's for both options. I think there is that excitement, and we've yet to see, as you say, proper evidence of how a partnership. If you even want to call it that, or a partial ownership of a club up here by a bigger club down there, is going to function in the sense that, I mean, we've discussed this in relation to Dundee and Burnley, and they've got their, you know, strategic alliance, as they've called it.
Probably further down the road than we get to see.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, but one of the questions that we've raised about it is, you know, it'll be interesting to see what happens when Burnley say they've sent these players up. Mm-hmm. You need to play them. Mm-hmm. Dundee have said that's not going to happen. That's not how this works. Whatever. Well, we'll see. So that's one of the potential things that might make a supporter go, well, not so sure about this. But at the same time, if there's, in Hibs' case, £6 million involved, then most fans are going to go, oh, brilliant, we'll have that, fantastic, that's going to lift us up to here. But the one thing for me about these partnerships, I'm not against them in principle or anything like that. I'm open to them, but I think that's because we've yet to see how they're going to work. So I'm willing to give them a chance.
And they'll probably all be different, just like buyouts are all different.
Owners of clubs are different. But the one thing about them that I'm yet to properly grasp or have explained to me properly is why? Mm-hmm. Why are they doing it?
Yeah.
What is the purpose of them?
I think it must purely be to be. It's a better. We're an easier country to get players into.
The European thing is interesting,
and it's for their own player development. Has to be. And a small change to sort of sweeten the pill and make it look like more of a partnership to chuck, in Hibs' case, £6 million. Mm-hmm. Who knows what it'll be in this case. It's they're not doing it for the status of having a share in a Scottish football club.
No, not at all. No, absolutely not. And as you've said before, just there when speaking about Hibs, £6 million, even to Bournemouth now, which sounds crazy.
It's nothing.
When you think about what Bournemouth have been traditionally. But £6 million is nothing to them. So it can't be about money-making and profit or anything for these Premier League clubs who are doing it. It's different if it's a buyout situation and you've got like a Mark Ogren at the beginning at Dundee United or, you know, St Johnstone's potential new owner coming in and looking at it and thinking, well, for a relatively small outlay in football terms, we could get to the group stages of the Conference League or the Europa League or whatever. Whereas in England, to do that same thing is going to cost you 100, 200 million to get to that point.
That's not what we're talking about with shares.
No, so that's ownership.
Yeah, that's ownership.
So up here it would cost, maybe you could do it for 10 million in good management and you're in the group stages. So that's achievable for buttons compared to what it would be elsewhere. So I understand buyouts in that regard. And there's also the prestige thing. If you're an American businessman who wants to show off. Yeah. Look, I own a football club that's 20 minutes from Glen Eagle, St Johnstone. Or United, actually Dundee and United for that fact. Uh-huh. I own a football club that's 20 minutes from St Andrews, Glen Eagles for St Johnstone. So this is all part of it as well. But the partnerships thing's different. So that's the bit to me that I don't yet fully understand. Mm-hmm. I don't get that really. So player development's one part of it, but I mean, it can't be for chasing profits.
Getting them in the country, you get these players, it's easier to get them. The door is wider open for Scottish football than it is for English football.
That said, the partnership thing, I'm thinking about the City group here in Man City, who have quite a number of clubs across the world at this point. But you look at, if anyone's looked at La Liga this season, seen it's Girona, who have not traditionally been, you know, title challengers, but they're right up there.
Girona, not Girona. You noticed that?
I initially didn't realise that they were owned by Man City this season. So I was looking at the table.
It's not a fairy tale. It's not a fairy tale. You might have thought.
And then you learn that Man City owned them, and you go, there you go.
Yeah.
So that's not something that I've kind of considered before about partner teams who actually go on to win leagues. But then you look at actually Brentford. The owner here who owned, I don't even know how to pronounce that team, so I've pronounced
the Danish team,
but I can't pronounce this one, the Danish team.
Yes.
Meteland.
So they've won the Danish league three times.
Yeah.
But Brentford have got rid of their ownership in there. So what was that about?
I know. There are far more questions than answers at the moment.
Still exciting though.
Listen, United fans, I mean, I've not been on Twitter this morning, but fans being fans, they'll jump all over it just now. They'll think, until they see any different, they'll say, this is going to be great. We're going to get this amount of money. Our Yanks are, or our owners are more, are richer than your owners and all that sort of stuff.
One thing that is an important factor in this for Dundee United, and this is in a very practical sense, is what division are they going to be in?
Yeah,
because I think that'll impact.
Well, that's what we were saying last week. That's the stakes are there, aren't they? In terms of, it's a different. It's potentially direction altering. United being in the top flight, they're not going to send up players for the Championship. That's for sure. So you say, okay, hold on, we'll wait a year, get yourselves up, then we'll come and talk. You know, so no, they are big stakes, and. Unless, Jim, you got anything else you want to say on it?
there are big stakes for Jim Goodwin and all the players here as well, because if they stay in the Championship, chance blown, you know, of an American owner coming in.
If Raith Rovers go up, are they suddenly going to go up? Well, is there going to be a club looking at them thinking, oh, well, we'll take them?
They'll be
cheaper to buy into.
Brighton and Brentford.
An American and Elka, you know.
It should be said, Brighton and Brentford are both their models have been super successful. That would fill me with a bit of
You could
excitement.
Say that, never mind multi-club models, but a model of how to run
a football club.
A smaller-sized, if you like, previously smaller-sized
Brighton in particular.
Club.
Brighton are out there
and
on their own.
Elevate it.
Tony Bloom is out there on his own.
They've both elevated their clubs from middling sort of outfits into, in Brighton's case, established. Club.
Brentford are in a bit of a wobble now,
But certainly the way that they've gone about it has been unimpeachable. He's brilliant.
Yeah, he was a mathematical genius, wasn't he?
He works on the
algorithm system.
I'm sure he still is, Jim.
For players. I'm sure he still is. It's not the sort of thing that deserts you, you know.
speaking from him.
But listen, this is fascinating. I mean, you're looking at English clubs. I mean, if you look at some of the names you've mentioned today, I mean, Brentford, Bournemouth, there's a club, you know. Bournemouth, I mean, of my generation, the only thing Bournemouth were famous for was Ted McDougall. If you're a Scot, yes. You know,
American owned again.
And Brighton, you know, Brighton Smith must score. We'll call to get the beam smudger, you know. I mean, other than that, I'm a decent sized club, by the way. I mean, they had
years of turmoil as well.
I mean, the only
slight thing that worries me is once you're out of local control, but the two Dundee clubs have been out of local control for a long, long time. And whether you're in local control, American control, or multi-club ownership control, the average fan has got little say anyhow. You know, and 80-90% of fans just want to see their team doing well. They actually don't care that much about the politics of the game, who owns it. And all. It's been proven with Newcastle. You know, Newcastle likes to kind of paint itself as a big kind of left-wing socialist city.
They swallowed their pride.
You know, there's been loads. Right. I mean, they've got this fans group that are fighting for, you know, for the rights of people out in Saudi and all the rest, and fair play to them, but the average Geordie doesn't seem to give it a damn, you know.
Turning up dressed as, in fancy dress. Yeah,
some of them. Yeah, but there's still playing 50,000 every week. That's the key thing.
That'll never change.
So that doesn't change, you know. It's intriguing, I would say. It's exciting. Potentially, it's intriguing. If I genuinely thought, the source that mentioned this to me the other week, if it was the Brighton one, said that Tony Bloom isn't the sort of guy that would come up and want to play second fiddle to Celtic Rangers. Now that's a tall order. However, if you look at Italian football, you know what I mean.
But then you've got Girona.
Yes.
And I'm going to say it again.
Yes.
The world changes. The world's going round. You know, the world is changing. So, there is no way on earth that a Dundee United in normal circumstances could ever compete with Celtic Rangers again.
I think if you're looking at a partial ownership model, there's no way that you could transform a Dundee United into somebody that's going to compete with Celtic Rangers.
No.
If you own 20% of a club, I mean, how much money you'd need to put in to get there is daft.
However, if you owned over 50% of the club, maybe you could.
Well, the devil is in the detail, the Champions League every year. That's the point.
The percentages.
Being the Champions League every year.
On the Brighton front as well, to reiterate, our United writer Alan Temple's information is that they have a more concrete interest in a different Scottish club. Mm-hmm. So.
And Brentford's own ownership is starting to... He's looking for a way out, isn't he?
I don't know. I think so.
There's a bit of flux down there as well just now. Sure.
Well, the fact that he's sold, he actually had a majority share in the Danish club. So the fact that he's sold that is interesting.
Yeah. No, I was looking at all these when I was in the early stages of writing about my potential St Johnstone story. And then it took a different turn. So I was looking at all the potential ones, you know, in the wake of the Hibs thing changing, and there's two or three others out there that, you know, you think, oh, that wouldn't you think? Ipswich was one that's kind of got that sort of background.
I just kind of think, I'm sure he'd be wanting to move on to kind of other local matters, but I mean, you know, my last point would be this. I mean, I think the key thing that emerges, whoever comes forward, whether it's Brentford, Brighton, whoever, I think you can safely say United are now in play. Mm-hmm. You know, in terms of, and they, I think
we knew
they had been, but I think now we're starting to see things, if not concreting up, you're starting to see a much firmer element.
In truth, when you think about Mark Ogren making the statement that there are more years behind me than in front, I think if anything, we're probably guilty of soft soaping that a little bit because that really is a
come and get it,
isn't it? So it has, whether United would say it's been on sale or not, I mean, it has been. Really.
Particularly with him barely giving an interview since.
Well, let's say, don't even frame it like that. It's not United that was on sale. His shareholding was on sale.
Well, that's how you always have to stipulate that. Yeah, absolutely. Right, okay. Going on the pitch. Mm-hmm. There'll be United fans, there's not many I'm speaking to are getting very excited about that. I have to say, we've been up and down with it a wee bit, just following what's been going. Although we have been seeing a trend, there's been a general trend from losing to Wraith.
Mm-hmm.
Just although there's been wee peaks, there's been a slide.
Yeah,
and I think fans, a lot of fans have been, you know, some of them will say they've seen this coming, and I totally get. I'm at the point now where I. I completely understand the panic going off the scale, not in terms of the points total, but that kind of still, if you'd said however many, how many games they've got left? Seven, eight?
Yeah, well, if Inverness, Race, Queen's Park, Morton, Ayr,
right, to have
Airdrie and finish it against Thistle.
To have that few games left and be neck and neck is enough in itself to have the panic rising, but it's to have to not be able to trust your team going into this stage of the season, not have a clue what standard performance you're going to get is a scary, scary place to be, I think, for a supporter. And
yes.
I think the fact that parts of the team that you kind of almost box off and say, well, that's all right. I mean, I only watch United on the telly, and I don't even see them all on the telly because Friday nights I'm usually coming back from the last football training and I'm catching up, so I'm fast-forwarding through a lot of this. But good grief, that one gave me the fear on their behalf because to see Declan Gallagher and Kevin Holt running around, it was like Keystone's Cops. It was just like, oh my goodness, what is happening here, Jim? I mean, you've seen a lot more of United, but well, did that must have been...
Well, there's a couple of things. I mean, one.
I don't know. I've tried something. Well,
defensively, defensively shambolic, both at fullback positions, central defence. You know, men chasing the ball instead of kind of staying with the.
It reminded me of the Falkirk Challenge Cup game.
Yeah, the signs have been there. I mean, you know, I've said all along, and in my heart of hearts, I still think they'll sneak over this line. But sneaking over the line really isn't good enough with the kind of. You know, the advantages that they've had.
We're into Dundee of last season territory
now,
aren't we?
Yeah, that was the sort of stuff that got Gary Boyer, he's obviously Gary Barlow, Gary Boyer, is his daughter, you know.
Get him as caretaker.
So, you know, from Jim Goodwin's position, from the player's position, these are guys, I mean, Jim is obvious, I think Jim's got another year, his contract, but there's a lot of United fans already very unhappy and thinking that if they do scrape up, is he the man to lead them in the Premiership? Are these the players to lead them in the Premiership?
That'll be a legitimate conversation in the summer again, given what Dundee did, but we're not at that stage.
It'll be a legitimate conversation if somebody does come in, a Brighton or a Brentford or a whoever, you know. But at the moment, they're neck and neck. They've got a much better goal difference. You know, the goal difference could be the thing that carries it at the end of the day, which would be a lousy way to go up, but you would still go up. That's a key thing. But defensively at the moment, all over the shop, as they were. Looked as though they'd kind of come back the other week, but you know, they fall apart against Dunfermline. And well beaten, by the way, no argument. Oh, I watched it.
Lovely movement up front from Dunfermline.
And fair play to James McPake. Very good performance from his side, Fuller running. Horsler, I thought, was terrific. You know, it's just all the things that United didn't do, you know, strong running, finding men with passes, playing at a tempo, all of these things.
I couldn't see what United were trying to do.
Couldn't either. I don't think anyone could. The fans certainly couldn't either, you know. So, I mean, they're fast approaching the stage where they're running out of excuses, I think. You know, now that seems ridiculous to say for a team that's sitting top
of the
league. It
does. It always does. That's been the continual problem. Anytime you've felt like our guts made us feel like United deserve a bit of criticism here. You have to say, well, then you look at the facts and the figures and you think, you pull back from it a bit, don't you?
When you and I and Sean sit here chewing the fat with this sort of stuff, you know, I mean, yeah, these are our opinions. But they're opinions based on being out having a beer, filling the car up with petrol, you know, being in the middle of the city centre, going to matches. I mean, this is what punters are saying. You know, this is not us saying it, and fans are saying, well, where did you come up with that opinion? You know, everybody loves Jim Goodwin, or everybody thinks their central defence has been brilliant. They've just been off key a couple of times. That's not what fans are saying. You know, fans are genuinely alarmed at what's going on at the minute. You know, slack defending, a lack of kind of creativity in the midfield, and a lack of goals.
They look at trends. You can sit here very easily and look at the league table, for instance, and say that actually wins, losses, draws, goals against, all that stuff is actually fine. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with that over the course of a season.
I would imagine their points at this stage is much higher than Dundee's was last season.
I would think so, So on that front, and then party to that, you can say that United have been very unlucky that Raith Rovers have happened to have, by their standards, a freak of a season. They've been excellent. So that's all true. But there's a but. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, what United fans are upset about is the ones that watch the team every week. It's general trends that concern them, basically. And it is, you know, a lack of authority about the performances a lot of time.
Unless they're playing Arbroath.
Well, yeah, I mean, for the second half of the season, for a lot of it, yes. Because as we've pointed out multiple times, they blew a few teams away early on. Mm-hmm. They haven't really done it since, other than Arbroath mm-hmm. at the weekend. Yeah. The previous yeah. weekend, sorry. So, a lack of authority, a lack of get up and go, a lack of intensity. That's what they're concerned about. And at this stage of the season, when you are neck and neck now with your rival, they've every right to be worried about that, yeah. to be honest with you. And especially, I mean, beyond that, and I'm getting a bit beyond myself now, but if you look at the playoff situation potentially as well, you've got Aberdeen getting sucked into that up there now. And good God, it would be quite a spectacle, but can you imagine United against Aberdeen in the playoffs, man? Oh, my goodness. That's a nightmare scenario for them.
I think just in general, you want to be coming into...
you winning this league.
You want to be coming into form, going into your big battle of the season, whether it's a relegation battle, yeah. whether it's a battle to get in the playoffs, whether it's the battle to win a title. Mm. You want to be feeling as if things are improving.
I think they feel it's a bit aimless.
And in control. At the minute, United are neither improving nor in control.
No.
And like I come back to my point there, I absolutely get why panic is off the scale yeah. amongst United fans. I'd really
do. Totally. Yeah, no, I absolutely understand that. And they've got one game this weekend, you know, against Inverness. And then the next one after that is massive. Mm-hmm. Absolutely massive. Pressure.
Oh,
how are you going to handle that?
Gut checks all over the place.
And as you say, United fans have no confidence that they will.
No.
Lee Wilkie and the Courier column was right. This is now how you handle the pressure. And the signs are not good. You know, the signs aren't good. I mean, I don't think anyone was expecting a Hearts-type championship season where he just blew the opposition away. But I think it was fair to think the United were probably...
They were after a couple of months.
A very decent lead, you know. So, you know, I think...
What do you mean? Right, let's break it down then.
A bit of mitigation for United, albeit not of their own doing, is the fact that Raith Rovers seem to be stumbling similarly.
I feel that they're stumbling less, if you see what I mean. I don't see that draw at Queen's Park, for example. Pardon me. The way this season's been going, I kind of expect them to lose. You know, just the way it's been yo-yoing. And I caught the last 15 minutes of the... I should really watch games. That was another night's training. It was the Wednesday when they played Partick Thistle. Mm-hmm. And the ball...
They weren't great in that
game. The ball did... almost literally didn't get into the Partick Thistle half. It certainly didn't get into the Partick Thistle goal mouth. It was back to the wall, but they kind of showed what you needed to show to dig out the result in that case. So I would, although they're far from bursting the tape as well, I do feel like they've got themselves together a wee bit better than United in the main as a general trend. But they've had their wobbles, but you wouldn't say you would hang your hat on them winning game after game at this stage of the season. I don't think either of them will win game after game now. Yeah. I think it'll be one of them will stumble over the line.
Yeah.
But so let's break it down a wee bit, Jim. I mean, did Jim Goodwin make a mistake in taking Ross Graham out of the team when he was banging for him?
Well, you know, I think at the time I said that Gallagher and Holt were the traditional pairing that had done very well, and I didn't think he did. I mean, although by and large I prefer to stay with a winning team, understood absolutely his reasoning in doing it. Two kind of experienced central defenders who...
It was a big call, wasn't it? An easy call.
Steered them well. It's difficult handling young players, but it's difficult to handling senior players. Yeah. You know, and they are the senior partnership. The problem is what looked fair 3, 4, 5 weeks ago might look unfair, you know, because ultimately...
Put him back in?
Well, who does he drop out? Is it Holt? Is it Gallagher, you know? Or does he go with three at the back?
What do you do?
I mean, those are the decisions that managers get paid for. Holt and Gallagher, I thought, kind of looked well off the pace against Dunfermline.
The third one was the biggest worry for me because Gallagher's the one you'd expect to hold that all together. I mean, what on earth he was doing going over to the other side and tracking a ball and leaving that space was the sign of a a team that was collectively losing its head, and that was scary for me. Yeah. That was scary for
me. I think the Gallagher thing's a bit of a red herring, because I mean that absolutely the Dunfermline performance defensively wasn't good at all. Jim said it before, they were ball chasing. It was like kids' football at times. Not knowing what they should be doing. It was poor. But before that, I mean, Ross Graham got dropped and Gallagher got brought back in after they'd lost to Raith Rovers. After that, and in the 1, 2, 3, 5 games after that, they took 10 points. So that's 3 wins, 1 draw. They only lost one. And after the Arbroath game last weekend, when they won that, they'd won 2 in a row. And you were probably thinking, that was the right call.
Morton away felt like it should have been there.
That should have been a great result. That was really, 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 really
not
good.
Not title winning, but that should have been the one.
And I mean, to be honest, even previous to that, drawing away at Partick was okay, because they're doing all right as well. So you would take that. So the results since he came back in have been fine, but Dunfermline was a mess. That was an absolute mess. So that, you've got to sort that out.
I don't think he now, I mean, I don't blame him for this, the way that results have gone. I don't think he's got, I don't think he'll know what his best team is at the moment.
Is there a best team?
We're going to start shouting for Cujo to come back on again.
I was shouting for Cujo. He's not coming back in, is he? He's just not that type of manager.
But the thing is, he did get a chance, didn't he? He was on it. But that's it. He's out again.
I think you're right, Jim. He doesn't trust him for whatever reason.
I know. It'll be interesting to see what happens at the end of the season, because you know, United will, I would think, maybe want to keep him, you know, but he'll probably want to move. They'll get a compo if he does go for training purposes and all the rest of it. It'll not be a fortune, whereas he looks to me like a young talent. But how do you keep a boy like that happy, who kind of feels as though he should be? I mean, I hear he's doing well in training, but, you know, if you're doing well in training, but you kind of get kind of going on the, you know, you kind of get off the bench to start, or you're getting kind of late appearances, you know, it's frustrating. It's almost frustrating. It's the same, you know, defensively. Just what we've been talking about defensively, it's exactly the same. Young players are bursting to play. They want to play. Mm-hmm. And if they see senior players, you know, for instance, if you're Cujo and you see Grieve coming in from St Mirren, who's been basically a reserve part player.
He's been incredibly disappointed. I think
I've said this before. I think we're just at that point of the season with Jim Goodwin, who... And the evidence that I've seen seems to be, and I understand this because there's a lot of managers who are very similar, but it's like, you know, protect, make sure that's a big part of your game plan. Make sure you can trust, you trust your players personally. They're going to do what you want them to do. And that's what it is. And I think Cujo probably doesn't fall into that camp. He is a wild card, and he'll do what he wants to do when he's on the pitch. And there are great sides to that. And that, you know, if he doesn't know what he's going to do, defenders don't have a clue either. And that can be brilliant. And the other side of that coin is, if you need him to dig in, maybe he's not going to do it.
Don't think Jim Goodwin's ever going to sign Joel Noble, eh?
No, exactly. So, and again, I've said, I think we're just at that point of the season where he's not going to roll the dice now. Because it's too tight. It's too tight. Mm-hmm. And I think this is just how it's going to be now. But the problem for United fans, and understandably so, is on the evidence that they've seen, by not rolling the dice, what you're going to get is more of what you've had, which is not exciting or thrilling. It doesn't fill you.
Managers act in character, don't they? Yeah. You know, I mean, there are very few managers.
They show you who they are.
Exactly. Very few have been defensive for 5 or 6 years, and suddenly, you know, but very few suddenly flip and, you know, and say, you know what, I'm going to, you know, five up front.
So like a Scooby Doo. Hey?
I don't think that Cujo will be starting anytime soon. That's from what I can see. You know, unless there's a kind of a remarkable change of heart from Jim Goodwin. The worry is exactly what Lee Wonky said, is how do they now handle the pressure? Because the pressure is on. And the pressure, I mean, the pressure on the next 2 home games, but the pressure in that Raith game will be absolutely intense.
Oh, it'll be wild.
Intense. Yeah. I mean, if the two of them go in as they are at the moment, I mean,
if they're going as they are at the moment, then United have had a dunt against Inverness, which they could well do without.
I think the mad thing, well, this is just an aside for this, but I don't think the BBC can't have that as a TV game now, because I think they've had their 2 Friday games at Tannadice.
You're breaking my heart there, Sean. So that's not even going to be on the box.
I don't think they can get that on the telly now. That would be box office. You could watch that.
I mean, the fixture list has been good to them now, though. If you're going to pick a team you'd want, Inverness, they're a team on the slide. I think they're the team that's going to finish second. Inverness at home. Yeah. I think his signings have been... He's Is he still signing people yet, Big Dunk? I mean, that's been incredible. Sure. Every time
I look at the BNG online,
somebody, his lad was picked up.
That was
up
the one I heard. Yeah,
so he couldn't get a goal at four for. So, aye, I think this is a good team for United to be getting just now. And
well, it's on them, isn't it? It's all on United.
You're quite comfortable. You're shaking your head. Do you think it's not a good unless it's our broth, it's not a good team that we have.
I'm not sure there's any good team for United to get at the moment. You know, I just kind of sense that there's a
pressure, you know, is it a crippling pressure at the minute?
We'll only know if they handle it come the final day of the season. You know, to be honest with you, I don't see them suddenly. I don't see a Wraith suddenly kind of, you know, falling apart over the next seven games, and United suddenly going on this, you know, huge unbeaten kind of run. So I think that this is what we're looking at from now to the end of the season. It's going to be two teams absolutely scrapping it out.
I think if Wraith were going to fall apart, they would have done it after our broth.
Yeah, that's right.
And they haven't.
And they didn't.
Mm-hmm. So, didn't. Fair play of them.
Oh, yeah, you dug the grave that night, as we all had.
I thought they were done. Just by the way they collapsed.
There's just a sense about Wraith. You know, I'm United, and the Wraith boys have been stirring that pot neatly all season, and why would they not? You know, there's a kind of sense that, look, we're a smaller club, we've got huge support, we're putting people back on, but we're all digging in together.
The social media United, man, kinda, he should be piling it up, he should be turning the dial to the max.
You can just see it. I mean, Wraith think United are the big-time Charlies. You know, and they're right to do so. United think they're the big time challenge.
It's clever. This is a real aside now, but I mean, if you're trying to create a narrative around a football club, which is what the social media person at Wraith is doing, is why we're talking about it, done a really good job of doing it. Of course you want to paint United as the big time challenge.
I think Andy Barrowman's doing a bit of that.
Absolutely. Nothing wrong with that whatsoever.
Of course, all of it piles pressure on United. Yeah. So they've done very well on and off the park on that front.
Right, Dundee, back off the pitch. Well, on the pitch, but off the pitch, if you see what I mean. The ball's not out because it was stuck in a puddle. Jim, nothing brings a spotlight on an issue like one half of the Old Firm being disgruntled. And it's kind of, it's turned the...
When are they not disgruntled?
Turned the heat up on the pitch. But, you know, it's turned a brighter spotlight on a subject we... debated on this podcast in the wake of this St Johnstone call off before the mid season break, the whole, and I thought George Cran's column on it was absolutely superb. He touched on every subject, and you know, it's what we were saying. If you can't, yes, it's this great if Dundee get their stadium moved, but you can't neglect the old place while you're in.
Unless that's part of the plan.
Oh, unless it's part of the cunning plan, but. You know, maybe we're being a wee bit, who knows. But anyway, fundamentally, your ground and your pitch needs to be fit for purpose.
Every bit of pressure you can apply, no, I'm not saying for a minute that's what happened Sunday. I mean, the pitch just kind of cope with overnight downpours and all the rest of it, you know. Yeah. George's piece was very good in it. He kind of hit all the right notes on it. He was critical enough of Dundee, and they deserve to be criticised. But in saying that, I've sympathy for him as well. I mean, there are times when any pitch in the world will simply, you know, not be able to handle a massive overnight deluge. That's a simple fact of life. Problem is, was that the fourth this season? Yeah. That's the fourth time this season at Dens. Now, traditionally, Dens, certainly pre-undersoil heat, we've talked about this before.
We're going way back now.
We've got to go way back. It was one of the great surfaces. But that's a long, long time. That's the ties of history stuff now. It apparently isn't anymore. I mean, there are chunks of that pitch that frankly look like kind of, well, are we doing a disservice to say the South Inch or the North Inch or Dundee's Riverside, the Coop, you know. I mean, just an absolute mess. Absolute mess. It was a Coop, in fact, you know. So, you know, the problem is, does it sort of thing it might pile pressure? Is it 12th of August they've got their one of their planning meetings, you know, good luck to the council trying to knock them back on it, you know, you'd be a brave councillor who would do that. But, you know, great, I mean, I think they're right to move to a new stadium given everything else that's going on. But they cannot continue to do this. I mean, the new stadium is at least 2 years away, you know, so they're going to have to invest
come up
in
May,
the
they need to invest in it in the summer.
Pointless now. I mean, there's no, I don't see what they can do at this stage, you know, as the season runs away, but they have got to invest in the pitch in the close season, whether they like it or not.
They've got to invest in that pitch. And if obviously this stadium plan is to an extent down the road, there's a council meeting on August 12th, like you say, allied to that, it might well be the case that Dundee are not spending huge amounts, they're spending minimum amounts, the minimum, to keep Dens Park
serviceable.
Usable, basically. Yeah. And that's fair enough. You're right?
Stand up.
So yeah. You're leaving. You're not going
to
put
it's
too
like
much
if you're selling a house, you want to get do enough to flog the place.
Exactly.
But, you know,
exactly. There's nothing wrong with that. But the pitch is a different thing. Because you're still playing on that. And that you have an obligation. Especially, I mean...
To your own manager and players as well, as we've said before. Right. You know,
I was going to say, especially in the Premiership, and that's true because there's live TV games all the time, so there's big money.
Image of the league, blah, blah, blah.
But it would be equally true if you were in the Championship. You're a professional football club. You need a pitch that you can play on. Mm. That's the bottom line. So there's no excuse whatsoever for not getting it sorted. They have to, whether they like it or they don't.
That was pretty much what Philip Clement was saying. I felt like actually a bit of, I mean, people are having to go at Clement. He's got to fight Rangers corner. You know what I mean? You know, nobody's going to point a finger at me and say, you're a great Rangers fan. But I mean, look, he's the Rangers boss. He's got to fight their corner. Would it have made any odds if they'd been told half an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours earlier? No, I don't think so. As Big Lee Wilkie said, would it have affected their prep? Maybe, I don't know, but I kind of see how it dramatically would have affected their prep had they managed to somehow or other put the game back a couple of hours, you know, in the hope that the pitch would have stood up to it then. Whether it was guesswork, you know.
I would underplay some of the travel stuff, right? Because he made a point of saying we travelled. I think, let's be honest, I'm pretty sure they stayed overnight somewhere nice nearby. But at the same time,
I think it's in St Andrews.
That's where they usually stay, because they were late last time, remember?
Exactly.
So, yeah, I mean, in the sense that the actual travel on the morning won't have been that arduous. At the same time, they've shelled out for an overnight somewhere. So, that's the Rangers and all that, but still, that's all true as well. So, Dundee have an obligation to their opponents as well as the league and everything. So, it can't continue. Next season, if this keeps happening, completely unacceptable.
Yeah.
Well, Dundee fans travel as well. There's obviously the bulk of them are Rangers fans. A lot of Dundee fans travel from out with the area. Jim Gellatley, Jim, the nephew, the former chairman. Jim travels from all over to see the D. You know.
I mean, the other element of that is there was a talk about, were they trying to get the kickoff pushed back or whatever to give it a bit more time? If you've got a live telly game, it's not going to happen.
Not going to happen.
It just isn't.
That's a red herring. No, agreed. And listen, football wise, I actually thought that this was prime opportunity for them. Rangers coming off getting taken out of Europe on a Thursday evening. Dundee coming off a good win and banging form. It was a bit of a, not a free hit, but we talked about it.
Tony Dunkerhill will be happy about this at all.
I gave them a really good chance. We'll never know, but football-wise, this was the injury that they feared. Owen Beck, back down the road.
It's a groin injury, isn't it?
How significant... Right. 6 weeks, that's right, isn't it?
Four to six, I think the suggestion was. Sure,
so you're getting close to the
end of the season.
End of the season. Mm-hmm.
So they might get him back for a little bit before the split. Gut feeling.
Couple of breaks as well.
Probably not. I don't know. My gut says no. Unless it's something that's treatable and it reacts really well to treatment, whatever, and he's okay. Mm-hmm. But I kind of, my gut feeling says that I can't see him coming back.
No.
So that being the case, I think it's a big blow.
we can't have we've sung his praises all season and told rightly so, and spoken about how crucial he has been to the Dundee game. I mean, they changed at one point. They changed their formation basically because they realised what they'd got in terms of this diamond of a player getting up and down the pitch and being that attacking threat. So is it enough to make you think? The balance in terms of, let's forget Europe, first of all, it's getting in the top six. Is it enough to make you think that the pendulum has swung towards the high Bs?
I think Hibs will probably get the job done.
Aye.
To be honest. Mm. Unfortunately. Because, I mean, genuinely, I'd love to see Dundee in the top six. Because
Dundee feels like Dundee have had a better season
than Hibs. It does. Yeah, absolutely. And actually... They probably have.
In terms of...
Relatively. In
where
terms
they came
of
up from and all the rest of it.
Dundee, Dundee, again, understandably, Tony Docker, he keeps labouring the point that we're just up in our first season. Of course you're going to do that.
It feels like they've been a better team.
Well, at their best, Dundee this season have been great. They've been really, really good to watch. Unfortunately, that, as I've said before, that gap between their best and their worst is quite wide. Mm-hmm. So I think that's what's let them down on occasion. But at the same time, I'm very, very reluctant to criticise them too much because, for the most part, I think they've done well. I would love to see them get into the top six because they have been an exciting team to watch when they've played well. And I think they deserve it for that. But I reckon Hibs will just slug it out and they'll get there now. Especially if Owen Beck's not there, because I do think he's a big miss.
Yeah, you don't get many players in Dundee, St Johnstone, these sort of teams that you said, think you could go straight into the Old Firm teams.
That said, the Rangers game going off, Tony Docherty will not be pleased about it because it's a chance. They had a chance this time, but at the same time, it's probably not one he's banking on. You're not going, right, we're going to pick up points here. Anything there's a bonus. But the fact that it's gone and they're going to have to fit it in.
It's got to be squeezed in before the middle of April, doesn't it?
Yeah.
April when they finish up against the Dons.
The fact that they've got to squeeze it in between these three games that they've got left now is a pain in the arse.
Inconvenience,
quite,
yeah.
But the other games that they've got, St Johnstone at home, we know St Johnstone have struggled this season. So Dundee at their best there. They'll probably be targeting that as three points. Yeah. They've got Motherwell in the other one. They've turned a corner a wee bit.
Still, that's more difficult. Still the better team than Motherwell. Yeah.
And then the final one's Aberdeen, who it really depends.
Not the worst running, is
what
it?
What happens with them? It's pretty good. There's points to be had there for Dundee in this running. So Owen Beck, big loss, but bar the Rangers game, winnable games.
He'll be back. I think he'll be back, and I think he'll sign for Celtic in the summer.
Who? Beck? You think so?
I think he's a Celtic player.
You know, he's that type of player. He kind of, you know, that fully back, winnie back sort of.
I think he'd really excel in a team like that.
Which across, and you know,
but he doesn't have much defensive responsibility.
No, exactly.
He can just
do your thing. Yeah.
I mean, I suppose it depends. I mean, it depends whether he's got another level to go up, because he's obviously got to go up another level. to dispose of Andy Robertson or something like that. Is he going to do that? Do you see it? Probably not.
I think Andy Robertson's such an exceptional athlete, first and foremost.
this kid's in the same mould.
Liverpool will probably sign a left back in the summer.
In the same mould, though. He's got that lovely kind of... He's snake-hipped, isn't he? He's got that lovely kind of athletic figure. He's sharp, he's quick, he changes. You know, he's got great balance. He kind of changes tack.
He'll come inside.
People, you know.
Andy Robertson doesn't tend to come in too much. He sticks to the touchline.
Yeah. And Andy Robertson, I just have to get my rage out of my system. Andy Robertson is one of the worst at shooting a ball I have ever seen in my entire life. For a man that cut back for him. Oh.
See, the thing
he's still raging about that result.
Oh, his technique is atrocious.
I seem to recall.
Leans back every cutback. That's going high.
I'll need to.
Again.
Andy Rowland would have put that away.
I'll need to check this out. United fans might remember better than me, but for some reason in my head, I've got it. They had a decent goal record at Dundee United. I think he scored a few.
I'm trying to remember. He scored a few.
I'll maybe do a piece on that. Anytime for Liverpool, he's.
But first and foremost, he's an athlete. And I think Owen Beck's a different sort of left back. Because he didn't charge up the pitch in the same way. And he does cut inside. He's got a few different things he can do. Yeah, I think you're probably right about Celtic.
Well, the chat was that it was virtually a done deal, and the Klopp just didn't have a clue and like gave him away.
There you go. Klopp know who he was.
Have 5 minutes at the end of that Bournemouth game, and then of course they'd have come back for, well, that means he can't go anywhere. He can't go anywhere other than Dundee. That was the chat. But there you go. All powerful at Liverpool is Mr. Jurgen Klopp, but not for long. Right, so where were we going? Oh, so yeah, they'll be playing Saints next, Jim.
Yeah.
And it was funny, other people other than St Johnstone, Dundee and Dundee United fans listen to this podcast, because I noticed your quotes, Jim, about the Celtic find their way into a wee piece online. It was about basically you talking up how Celtic are, you know, at their best, the pass and move, that sort of football that nobody can match. And I was... And we got a bit of that, actually. Saints, that was a glimpse of... I'm kind of changing my mind.
Well, Levine touched on that, didn't he?
It made me change my mind a wee bit on where the title's going, because I was very much in it's Rangers, Rangers, Rangers. Mm-hmm. And then I saw the real Kyogo again and a couple of guys that were on his wavelength. Yeah. And although Saints actually kept them at bay very well for the first 30, whatever minutes it was.
But, when did Sprango go off?
He got a knee injury. Well,
when did he go up?
When 25, and it changed. Yeah. The tempo, the flow of the game changed after that, and then they start to get more shots. Yeah. So that was a big point. Mm. But no, it was more like watching a Rodgers team of old, yeah, or a Postecoglou team where it was pop, pop, pop. And Kyogo, I don't know what had gone wrong with him. Celtic fans will tell me. But you know that little dart and run, mm-hmm, outside to in that got him so many goals, mm-hmm, that kind of dried up. He was doing that a lot, and mm-hmm, we're the best one in the world. Your McGowans and your Considines, no, you know, this is when he's doing that, he's the best in the country by a mile at doing that. And you know, VAR saved Saints rightly, but not saved, you know, they were offside.
Well, he started a lot of those runs. He started them in an offside position frequently. I remember when he first came to Scotland, there was a lot of discussion about that.
Whether he was
taking advantage of this rule or whatever. Mm-hmm. And of course he is, mm-hmm, but it's allowed. So
I mean, from a St Johnstone point of view, it turned into one of those that they were poor at holding on to the ball, which I thought Levine was absolutely, he nailed his post-match reflections. They were poor at holding on to the ball. Boys like Dan Phillips had a bang average game at best, you know, so they couldn't really get out. Sidibe, mm-hmm, didn't do well in the odd chance he had to get the ball up the pitch. So
I was surprised he started.
Yeah, I was as well. If there was one game when, you know, you'd want to fit Chris Kane, it would be that type, yeah, of game, you know. Mm-hmm. But obviously, that's nearly.
He's going to. I see in your August publication this morning, is Levine saying he's going, Phillips? Did I see that?
Yeah, well, he's likely. Yeah, contracts up with kind of open secret there. Yeah. But yeah, I was just. You get to a certain point in the game, and you look. You were talking about goal difference for United.
Yeah.
For Saints to emerge from that game to still have a better goal difference than Ross County, mm-hmm, I think that's your minimum. And when a game plays out like that,
yeah. It's kind of depressing to, and I mean, Celtic Rangers have lost this season, but they just don't lose very often. You've got to catch them. You've got to be
absolutely playing well.
You've got to be absolutely your best, and you've got to catch them, be five or six or seven, yeah, right off for them, you know. So you're right. I mean, you know, with all due respect to Considine and Gordon and people like McGowan at the back and all the rest of that, you're not knocking them. They're good, honest professionals. They're coming up against guys that have just got a touch and a movement and a speed of thought. That, you know, that, I mean, you can cope with it for 25-30 minutes,
speed across the grass.
When these guys were at the peak, the Saints defenders, you would struggle against it.
It wears you down playing against that for kind of, you know, by the time you get kind of 60 minutes into a game, physically and mentally, you're absolutely done. You're done in. You're just done in, you know, because they're on a different level. That's no criticism of players that are playing against them. That's the reason they're at Celtic. You know, and it's the reason why Celtic get cuffed in Europe, that the boys at Celtic are not at Barcelona, are not at Liverpool. You know, that there are grades of everything. But that Celtic side on form have players that
Celtic
can move
have
a ball.
Been crap in Europe, hasn't it? Just,
but. Anyway. you know what? It's a lost leader almost for St Johnstone. The key thing now is how they stay above Ross County.
I think it's ahead. Maybe I was a wee bit premature in letting Aberdeen out of the picture. Mm-hmm. Possibly even Motherwell. Possibly even, you know, if I know it's a big if, but if Theo Bear stops scoring goals, mm-hmm, you know, maybe they're not too far ahead, but my gut tells me it's a head-to-head between Saints and Ross County now.
I would think so. Yeah, I would agree with that. And I don't think we'll see the winner of that until after the split.
And you knew by the way I was speaking this time last week, this was always the period where I thought Ross County are going to make up ground. They're going to steal a mark. They had a game in hand.
Yeah.
What, two games at home? I thought it'd be the other way around. I thought they'd beat Hibs and probably draw with Hearts, but Hearts are the only team now in the country that don't have anything to play for.
Right. Yeah. That's
apart from
right.
the cup, mm-hmm. you know. So
right. very safe.
It's started, it so. Was it, that was they've, so they've not taken full advantage. They're not going above Saints, which I thought was. I thought they could win both mm-hmm. games. Mm-hmm. They're within touching distance of Saints. Mm-hmm. Now they're both off bare feet for what they're going. I think Saints last three before the split slightly better because they're not got an Old Firm team than Ross mm-hmm. County's, but. So I want Saints to be 4 points ahead of them going into the split, which isn't done and dusted because they obviously play each other, and you know that four points isn't as big a gap as you think going into the split. But that would be my target for them now.
Well, I think they're going to need Owen Beck's loss for Dundee to be catastrophic to win that game. Unfortunately, Hibs away. I think that'll be a tough.
And then Kelly at home.
That'll be tough. So I'm not sure about how far ahead or not they'll be by the split. I think they could be second bottom by the split.
It could be.
I think the key period will come after that.
As it did last season.
Yeah, we'll find out after that. Because that's when you're playing the dross, as it were. So I think it's going to be an uncomfortable few weeks for St Johnstone. Unfortunately,
they couldn't have to have been Dundee, couldn't they?
Oh my God!
In terms of psychologically,
yes, they could.
To energise the supporters, everything that goes with it.
Big time.
I know this is before the split, whereas the Dundee United one was the first game after the split. Yeah. But that game, when Saints beat United, was the definitive one for me in terms of last season. Remember the 1-0? No, the 1-0. Remember the first game after the split?
At McDermott,
Liam Gordon scored it, remember?
Oh, right,
and then Steve Fletcher hit the woodwork right at the end.
Oh.
But I think if St Johnstone beat Dundee, my confidence would... I'd be sort of 80% confident in Saints staying up.
It would be great. I'm still confused by St Johnstone post winter break, to be honest with you.
Got a few issues now. Sprangler's in and he's probably going to be out.
To me, he's for a guy who I thought was one of the standout performers in a poor first part of the season, who then lost his place in the side when Craig Levein came in. But it was difficult to argue with because initially
Phillips and Smith were
fighting well and they were putting performances in. After the break, that stopped and he's obviously got back in.
I'd have had him in sooner as well.
I would have as well because he's a terrier. He fights and goes for it. So losing him, that is a problem. Leaves the midfield a bit toothless, I think. I worry. I do worry. Yeah. I really, really
You're
do.
You're a worrier, though.
I am a worrier. Well. But I'm concerned. And then up top as well, it really, really depends for me about what Craig Levein decides to do with the shape of his team. He's played three.
Not spoken to him this week yet, so I'll be asking him about why Nicky Clark. I'm presuming he's just thought, what's the point? This isn't his type of game.
Well, maybe not. But I mean, what was wrong with Kempioka? Was he injured?
No, I think he thought Sidibe would be better at holding the ball up, and it didn't work out that way.
I'm not sure. Well, obviously Craig Levein sees him every day in training and what have you, and gets information from Andy Kirk from sessions and what have you. So if he's holding the ball up well in training, that's one thing. But I haven't seen much evidence of that on the pitch, personally. I don't think he's a hold-the-ball-up type player.
He's better at it than Kempioka.
I think so.
Once we judge them over a big body of work, I think he's probably... Okay. I think Kempioka has... He's better when he looks for that ball over the
Gets
shoulder.
Over the shoulder, So, yeah, a lot of that... It's again, as it has been all season... and probably a lot of last season, actually. A lot of it depends on whether St Johnstone can manage to ally being strong at the back with having some attacking outlet, because that's where they struggled all season. Can they get the ball forward and can they keep it there and can they do something with it when it's there? That's where they've struggled, and that's what I'm unsure about. So, I don't know.
You just have to... There'll be a lot of players that know they're likely not going to be at clubs across the length and the breadth of the country. And
does he bust a gut?
That's why I always think that signing good characters is as important as signing good players.
And Levein, in that quote speech you're referring to, he has absolutely zero doubt that Phillips will be a warrior for him to the end.
Good.
So you just have to...
That's what they'll need.
Well, you're looking for guys that are just absolute professionals, and the vast bulk of players are. You know, they get on with the job whether they think they're going down or whether they think they're going to be there. They get on with the job and they wire in. You know, they can't afford to be thinking about might I get injured if I slip in for this tackle or whatever. I mean, because there are, you know, I mean, unless he's got a move absolutely nailed down, his agent presumably will be saying to him, look, we've got interest from England or wherever, so, you know, keep playing away there, you know, the more clubs we have interested, the better. So it's in the players' interest as well, both as a professional for the club and as a professional for himself, you know, to get his move.
And managers speak to managers, don't they? They pick up the phone and say, what was he like for you?
That's right, because, I mean, you know, football's a global village. And very quickly, it only takes kind of one manager to say another, because Levein will know hundreds of people south of the ball. He takes say, kind of, listen, this lad is a gem. We'd love to keep him. You know, we kind of do it, but you know, he will not let you down. As opposed to with somebody else, you're buying trouble here, mate. I couldn't get anything out of him. You know, he just down tools with 10 games to go, that kind of thing. You know, so I don't think there's any fear of players downing tools or the good ones all not down tools. You know. What you don't get at this stage in the season is you don't suddenly discover that you've got somebody in your books that can score a barrel load of goals from nowhere, or can, you know, can hit magnificent crossfield passes, and you think, where was that all season? So what this now comes down to is kind of attitude and graft. It's as simple as that. I mean, there's a much or muchness about all of these sides from kind of from Motherwell down. On their day, any of them could be any of them. So, you know, putting my optimistic and pessimistic hats on, pessimistically, Saints could easily end up in second bottom position here. Optimistically, the playoff position gives you a much better, you know, if you're going to go, if you're going to be in the relegation zone, the last thing you want to do is go down automatically. That's you gubbed. But, you know, if you've got to finish, you finish second. That way, at least you've got a crack at things.
Are we going to see Dre right?
Yes, I think so. Unless I get here a different team, that would be a biggie.
Well, that's interesting.
That would be a biggie. Mm-hmm. I mean, listen, again, I'm not at the stage of sort of doing big sweeping reflections on the season, but we all know that there was a point in the season where, well, St Johnstone fans were all saying it, we were all thinking it, probably saying it on here as well. You'd have taken your chances at second bottom, but when in the situation they're in now, you wouldn't, not now, not when it's there to be done. I think there'll be there's an intriguing dynamic to it now as well, in that the three teams you mentioned, Aberdeen, well, the numbers bear it out, Aberdeen, Motherwell and Ross County, all carry more of a goal threat.
100%.
I think St Johnstone, if you get what you expect to get from St Johnstone, are better at the back than them all. Which is going to get you out of trouble? Than that will see.
I know.
That's where we are.
It's going to be ugly. It's going to be ugly, isn't it?
I've known that for a while. That's what. And you've got a manager. And I think St Johnstone have got the best manager for the job out the lot of them as well. We don't know who Aberdeen's manager is going to be.
God, aye.
Yeah. I think
from a St Johnstone perspective, the longer they go without one, the better.
You think so?
Absolutely. Yeah. I think so. Because, I mean, obviously they've beat Motherwell at the weekend there, but, I mean, in certain performances prior to that, they just look completely gone, rudderless. And that's great for Saints. Mm. So.
Who would you? Well, here's one for you, because I'll not be here next week. I'll be on my holidays next week. Who do you want? What result do you want? Aberdeen, Ross County? I would say an Aberdeen win, but there you go.
I suppose, yes, given the league table, that's you've got to be a draw at worst, but yes, being pragmatic about it and taking out desire to see Aberdeen in the playoffs.
The lulls.
Can you see it happening? You know,
I think Ross County win.
An Aberdeen win, yes, you could. But pure pragmatism, that's what you'd want. And it probably takes Aberdeen out of reach. But there you go.
I think
you're right with the manager. This is, to a great extent at this time, it's not even about how you set your team up, whether, you know, how you play at the back, how you set your midfield up or whatever. Now it's about a manager that's kind of been through the course. You know, he's managed Hearts, he's managed United, he's managed Scotland, he's managed Leicester. You know, he's got a huge amount of kind of individual experience, and he reads a dressing room, and he reads players, and it's how you kind of, you read players and how you lift them, and just the wee things you do and you say with them over the course of the next coming weeks. You know, the guys that maybe the heads are doing a wee bit worried about their future and all the rest of it. I think that's the other side of management. There's management and there's coaching. And management is a different skill from coaching.
Well, coming from a man who's never managed a football team in his puff, I think he needs to play County Oka and get Clark into that team. That's where the goals have come from. Okay.
Well, there we are. Good. I don't want to spoil your fun.
You can
go on.
Sure, he's cheering in.
Yes, indeed. Right, thank you, guys. I think you'll have a missed call for Tony Bloom to go and go and phone him back, Jim. Okay, right. Thank you very much, guys, and thank you for listening. We'll be back next week. Bye-bye.